Series of social and cultural conventions that are associated with the use of ink, its application with the brush on paper, and how to read meaning into the marks made by brush. Okay, so there's many, many social conventions. For instance, when one paints a landscape or one is engaged in calligraphy, there's a lot of historic cultural meaning to that. So only by understanding the cultural context and the signification that happens through the brush acts that you can truly understand what the artist is doing. So it's a language. It's a language which expresses a world. And this world, and we talked about this in the morning, this is the world which I would call the pre-modern Chinese worldview. So this is the worldview before this deep sort of conflicted engagement with the West, in which China has this kinds of survival or existential crisis and becomes rapidly, quote, modernizing by westernizing. So this whole last 100 years, before this last 100 years, okay, there was a pre-modern Chinese world. And this is, I think, the world that the ink arts articulate. Now, this is not a static world, this is a world that's been evolving, at least since the creation of the medium in the Han Dynasty. So this is a world that the ink has been documenting as it's unfolded over the last 2,000 years, roughly. So, starting with that, I'd like to talk about an artist, Wang Dongling. Many people consider him one of the greatest living calligraphers today in China. One thing that you may notice, though, is he's doing calligraphy in public. Okay, so calligraphy, formerly, or previously, or think of traditionally, it's letter writing, mostly. So the great examples of calligraphy are oftentimes personal letters or personal writings to, from one very educated person to another very educated person. So what Wang Dongling has done is he's actually taken this practice out of the private studio and he's taken it into the public sphere. This is a lot like performance. When you go to the theater, for instance, and you see a dance performance, or you see a musical performance, or a theater performance. So he is an artist who is not just a calligrapher, but he's a performing artist or a performance artist, depending on how you want to categorize him. And you can see in his performances, I don't see if you can see on the left-hand side corner, the scale of what he does. And then maybe here's a little bit clearly, you see in the background, there are dancers. So he's very explicitly aware, by adding dancers, he's telling you that calligraphy is a performing art, not just a visual art. Now, all cultures have performing arts, right? We have dance, we have, again, musical performance, we have theater. Many anthropologists believe that the first human art was some form of ritual, communal ritual. So the first human art may in fact have been a performance. The other thing that you can see is in a performance, you have to be in the physical presence of the artist. Okay, what's the difference between a visual art or a sculpture and performing arts? You have to be in the physical presence of the performance and the performer to actually experience the art. Right? If you go to the theater the next day, and after the performance is done, you don't get to experience the art. Okay? If you go and attend an event at the right day, but it's the wrong location, again, you don't get to experience the performance. You must be in the physical presence of the performer to experience and to connect with the performer and receive that inspiration. So, I'm just bringing this up. Can you see the figure? Can you see the moment of elation when he's completed the work? You can feel what the artist is feeling. Okay, and this is something which you can actually experience if you're there at the physical performance. Oftentimes when he does a physical performance, he's 7 years old, he will leap up into the air when he's done. This is something you can only experience there. And yet, when you look at this work, can you not somehow, for some reason, in some way, feel that same energy? Okay? So what's extraordinary about calligraphy is that it is a performance, but it's also a medium that has recorded that performance so that you can take this work at another time, 1,000 years later, at another place 10,000 miles away, open up the scroll, and the performance is there. It's recorded, it's captured. Now, it's a little bit different than an actual performance in the sense that we, the audience members, are actually quite passive in a performance. We just simply sit there, the performance is happening in front of us, and we just feel, like when you're at a concert and the music is happening, you don't have to do that much to actually enjoy the performance. But when you look at a work of calligraphy, in order to truly appreciate the performance, you have to re-perform the act in your mind again. So the way to look at this is not to look at it as an overall composition. The way to look at this is to follow the line in your mind, with your finger, with your body in some way, as if you are Wang Dongling re-performing the calligraphy. When you do that, you enter a parallel time and space to the creation of the artwork. You assume the position of the artist in the recreation of the work. This kind of imaginative re-performance is the power of the medium of calligraphy, power of the language of calligraphy. So I've spoken to many, many people, art historians around the world, said, can we think of another medium, another art medium that captures performance in this way? And the earliest we can come up with is the invention of film and audio recording, maybe sometime in the 19th century in Europe. I have yet to have somebody explain to me another medium that actually captures performance in this way. It is this quality of ink that has captured the imagination of Chinese artists and Chinese culture for 2,000 years. It's not because Chinese culture is conservative that we haven't done anything other than ink. It's because ink uniquely is able to record this idea of performance. So where does this come from? Philosophically, this comes from this notion. You know, we have this notion, this mistaken notion in the West from Descartes, that the mind is separate from the body, that the mind is transcendent over body, that the only way that we human beings can create knowledge outside of our individual selves is through this idea of universal reason that resides in the mind, that is distinct from the knowledge that we gain through our body. In China, this is not something that any Chinese philosopher had ever considered. It's not something that's embedded in the culture at all. Instead, we have this notion that mind, consciousness, is embodied, so that your body and your mind are, in fact, one thing. So we have a Chinese character for it. It's called xin. So the Chinese character for mind, xin, is also the organ or the entity that gives us our emotions, our feelings, our perceptions, our imagination, our rational thought. It's also the same organ that gives us our moral sense, most importantly, our moral sense. That's all one thing. That's divided up into many, many different things in Western philosophy. Okay. So what we're looking at in calligraphy is this notion that the brush is connected to and is an index of the heart, of the self, of the xin. So what makes calligraphy great is the fact that through a connection through our body, through the brush into the paper, when that brush touches paper, it very subtly records the state of our xin, our heart. Not just our momentary state, but then also our cultivated state, our state of character. So as Yang Dechang would say, after repeated action, accumulation results in transformation. Well, your state of transformation is captured in your brush touch, reflected. So what does this look like? Okay, so here are two examples of Tang Dynasty calligraphy. I'll read a few words out, and you tell me which example you think it describes. So, first is angry. Another is free. Another word is distraught. Another word is ebullient, joyful. Another is grief or sadness. And the other is, let's see, I'll use the word charisma, charismatic. So do you have a sense for which of those two states are described by which calligraphy? So, the first example, the one on the right, was by Huai Su, a Buddhist monk, famous for his cursive calligraphy. A bit of an iconoclast, also a bit of a celebrity. So this is his autobiography. It's an extraordinary text in which he writes about himself in the most immodest ways, talking about how amazing, how fantastic, how many people have lauded how extraordinary he is. And this is the calligraphy that goes with it. This is Yan Jianqing, Tang Nanxi calligraphy, great high official. This is something he wrote during the Anglishan Rebellion. And it's basically a draft of a requiem for his nephew who had been killed in battle. So, again, comparing the two, the state of character and the state of mind, the momentary state of mind of the artist is captured in both of these works, not just in the text, but through the quality of the line itself. So here's Wang Dongling performing to large audiences. Part of what he's doing is he's sharing this relationship through performance in calligraphy with a much broader audience. You can look at this as the artist through the brush sharing an experience with the viewer. Now I just use this graphic as a way of starting to talk about that. And you can essentially see how he's connecting with larger audiences. Not just older audiences, so this is audiences not just in China, but this is an audience in the Netherlands. And it's just, you'll notice here, there are a lot of older people here. There are performances that, in which he really touches and works with young people. And here is a performance that took place in Brooklyn. If you have time, I'll show you some video. But you can basically see how large of an audience gathers around him. He describes this exchange as a qichang. So a chang is like a commons, an open space, okay, in which there's an exchange of qi, of energy that happens. Okay, so there's performance art that happens in the West, okay, but this is something very different. So that's one thing. So the brush as an index of the heart. Another thing I'd like to talk about is this idea of landscape. There's a lot of landscape painting in Chinese painting. This is a painting by Guo Xi in the 11th century. Does anybody know why we paint so much landscape in this Chinese tradition? You know, there's a really important philosophical shift that happens during this time. So before, when you think of Confucian philosophy is about what? It's about our relationships in society. It's about one's own moral sense or our own moral cultivation. So why are we, if this is the philosophy of the culture, then why are we painting so much landscape? Well, in the Northern Song, what happens is Confucianism is searching for a cosmology. Okay, you can do Confucian philosophy without mentioning anything about the natural world. And in fact, Confucius says very little about the natural world. But by the Song, there's a recognition that claims about whether or not, you know, human nature is in fact this Confucian human nature rest upon this relationship between human nature and the larger universe. So there's a desire to find a cosmology that explains the Confucian human nature. And that cosmology looks like a much broader study of the natural world. So the Neo-Confucians create a system of the theory of the natural world that then explains how Confucian moral theory is a natural theory. And so nature then becomes this key image or key metaphor. So what happens is in Northern Song, if you want to paint about one's own personal moral nature, you paint a landscape. If you actually want to paint an image of your relationship to other people, you paint a landscape. If you want to paint an image of the larger moral functioning of society, you paint a landscape. And of course, if you want to paint the natural world, you paint a landscape. It becomes the universal metaphor, and it's a beautiful articulation of the underlying philosophy. So they call this Dao Xue in the Northern Song, Li Xue in the Southern Song. So what's going on here? this basic idea is that there's a universal substance called qi, and that everything in the world is made of qi. Qi moves and qi flows. The natural world is made of qi. And in fact, your embodied mind, your body and your mind, is all made of qi. But this qi basically coheres and it assumes certain patterns. Say li, dao li de li. Okay. And so anything that has a form also has its own li. This li emerges out of flows of energy. Okay, so energy, this qi, is constantly flowing, right? And there's an order that's maintained, tai ji. So all these elements go together in terms of forming who we are. What's interesting is that the world around us and us, we human beings, are made of the same stuff, qi. And this same stuff is constantly moving according to its own pattern and according to its own rhythm. And so as a result, these two things, our minds and the natural world, can come into a kind of resonance. Yun. So this idea is qi yun. And this is a key aesthetic term in Chinese painting. In fact, it's the one thing that we say when we judge a painting. Does it have qi yun? So what does this mean? This sounds very, very abstract. If I hear music, and all of a sudden, my hands start moving, or my feet start moving. At first I'm listening, there's no motion. Then all of a sudden I start moving. That means my body, my mind is in yun with the music. Okay? That's qi yun. If, let's say, I'm going out into the natural world, let's say I go out and visit the mountains, and I see the waters, I see the lakes, I see a beautiful scene. Okay, and all of a sudden my mind becomes much more expansive and much more peaceful. I have this certain feeling that comes from looking at the scene, being in the natural world. You can say that your mind or your body is now in yun with the natural world. You've achieved experiencing qi yun. Okay. Let's say you're sitting down with a friend, and your friend is sharing with you a very joyous experience, and you see it on their face, the joy, and it makes you feel very, very joyous inside, and you smile. Okay, that empathetic response is yun, qi yun. Your friend has a certain emotional state, qi. You empathize with that, and you begin to experience that state. That's qi yun. So it's something which is not mysterious, it's actually central to who we are as human beings that we're able to do this. And what's fascinating is we can have qi yun not just with other humans, we can have qi yun with all kinds of things which are not human. Now how is this possible? The reason why is because the whole world, according to the Neo-Confucian system, is made of one thing, which is qi, energy flowing, assuming pattern with certain resonance. Well, guess what? This is actually how modern science explains the physical world. We call it in the West condensed matter physics. But that's essentially not far at all. What I just described in terms of Chinese terms, that's not far at all from how things are described in condensed matter physics. If you hear the terms chaos, complexity, and emergence, these are new fields of science related to condensed matter physics. That's the way the physical world is described now by science. So if we take this idea that the mind is embodied, and we place it in resonance with the world. Okay, this is what the Chinese were working with in their pre-modern worldview. Okay, and this is the basis for the art making. So we have our landscapes. So this is Guo Xi's an early Song landscape. The way I describe this is the artist at the center in qi yun, in resonance with the natural world, okay, goes into the studio and paints. Achieves a state of qi yun with his materials, okay, and is able to produce a landscape. What happens then is we judge the painting as to whether or not it also is in resonance with the landscape, with the natural world. So when we judge a painting and we say this painting has qi yun, basically what we're saying is the qi of the landscape is in resonance with the qi of the original natural image or the original nature. That's how we judge. going back to this notion of calligraphy, this calligraphy notion was a little bit different. The brush was the index of the heart of the artist Xing. If we were to combine this notion of qi yun, okay, with this idea of the brush being an index of the heart of the artist, then we get later Chinese landscape. So landscape after the Song, from the Yuan Dynasty forward. So in the Yuan Dynasty, we reintroduced calligraphic brushwork into landscape painting. So the entire system now is that the artist, in resonance with the natural world, picks up the brush and creates an image that's in resonance with the natural world that is at the same time an expression, an index of his state of consciousness and his state of character. It's two things at the same time. And what does this look like? So this is a landscape painting by Huang Binghong, certainly later. And this is the Guoxi. If you were to look at details, you can see how the Guoxi, there's not, if you could get really close and read the brushwork, but generally speaking, the purpose of looking at the Guoxi, the purpose of his use of the brush is to capture an image that resonates with the natural form of the tree. It's much more descriptive, it's much more realistic. There's something more than pure description though. There's a certain quality, there's a certain energy, there's a certain air that he's communicating. Okay, but description is key. On the left you see the Huang Binghong. You see the brush touch. You can read the brush touch like you can read the calligraphic brush touch. This is conveying something about Huang Binghong's mind at the same time. So there's natural form, and then there's this, shall I say, more abstract expression, which points to something else, which is the scene of the artist. Okay. So if we were to look at a detail a little bit more closely, you can see how there's a naturalism there, and then you can also see how there's a gestural expression there, combined into one form. Each touch carries both levels of meaning. Gestural meaning, gestural expression, and in addition to that, natural formal expression. So if we were to then look at how this works, when we are looking at the painting, these are the two sorts of things that we should be able to see. So again, an artwork is both an image that has resonance with the natural world, as well as brush gesture, which is an index of the mind of the artist. So when you look at this, this is a detail, can you feel that resonance, that chain of resonances? So thinking about music, feeling music, can you feel the vibrational resonance? Can you see it? So next I want to talk about another artist who's also a landscape painter, Li Huasheng.